a time of speed, a time of fast transition and fast communication, fast everything, where all the certainties that used to shape the world around us are constantly blurring or splitting apart. And I think that, especially when it comes, you know, to living in a big city, you can almost feel that we're constantly between one place and one face, one moment and another, but without fully belonging to either one. I think that as an expression, as a consequence of this uncertain contemporary condition, we almost seem to have lost the ability to stay still and to breathe at a slower pace. The ability to fully immerse ourselves in our present time, in the here, in the now, in the, you know, tangible, real reality, kind of lost the contact with real people, with human, real connection. Simply, you know, our own experience of being alive. And I personally, as a woman and as an artist, I get deeply affected by this, by all of this. And, you know, I can almost claim that I feel extremely uncomfortable with my own era because of that, because of this constant overflow, you know, of images or things and, you know, so-called information, which really doesn't leave you anything but lack of focus. And this is probably my biggest struggle, like the ability to step out of this and really find the time to, as an artist, to understand, to go back to a slower way of living and therefore making art. I think it's interesting that the paradox of this high-speed life that we've been witnessing for at least the past decade is itself the force, in fact, that I feel is pushing us towards a new need, a new desire for slowness. I mean, at least I can talk for myself and my own practice, which is changing and is really going towards that. And as you know, as an artist, I think that my only salvation, the only way I can protect myself is through my work, is through my practice. And what I mean by that is two things. On one hand, is that I've been, of course, through photography, which, you know, is my main language, developing a workflow which is itself very slow and really allows a space for thought and contemplation, so I feel safe. It really respects, you know, my biological time, my own pace, and that makes me feel good. It's the only way I can protect myself. And on the other side is my practice itself. Through my practice itself, I really, in the end, if I have to detach myself from my work, because when you do make work, you, most of the times you don't really know what you're actually doing. But if you detach yourself and you analyze it, then I can clearly see, but in the end, all I've been trying to achieve is create a sort of suspended moment, the prayer, you know, like a sort of miracle, a space where, you know, time and space are suspended, and again, it's a space for experience and time. I'm an artist, and my practice has been mainly focused on photography for the past few years. And I come from a fine art background. I started with painting and drawing, which is my first love since I was a child. So as far as I can remember, I've been always creating images, and I've always had this, you know, this drive, this need. I didn't really know what it was, but like the desire to create something, to make art. Then my father, who's a photographer, one day he gave me a camera so I could play. And that was it, really, nothing super romantic about the choice of this language. It just became a tool, and I started playing. Then, you know, I started studying cinema and digital art, and that was about, I think, 10, 12 years ago. And it was a very exciting season of my life, and I was so greedy and curious, you know, I wanted to do everything and experiment and know as much as I could. So on one side, you know, moving images, experiment with that, and perhaps one day become a video artist. And then at that time, I would have a studio where I would exclusively paint and draw, or at least try to. And at the same time, started already taking photography more seriously. So already having exhibitions with some paintings and then photography. And then in this beautiful, confusing, exciting season, this beautiful time of my life, something really important happened to me, something necessary that I would really define almost miraculous. I had a big crisis. And I just asked myself, who am I? Where am I supposed to go? Where do I belong? And how, which form does this thing that I've been always carrying inside me, and of which I've only seen, you know, scattered glimpses of through all these languages, which way this thing needs to be, you know, needs to come out? And then, honestly, the answer was that it really didn't work out for me at the very beginning of my career, my professional practice, artistic practice, you know, to be spread between all these languages. So I had the need to channel all these intentions and energy and just focus on one thing. And that thing was photography. Why photography? I don't know. It was relevant, it made sense at the time, it was the closest thing. And then I left Rome, where I come from. I'm Italian. And I moved to London when I did a master in photography. And that was around 7.5 years ago. And pretty much since the end of my master, I can say that my professional life started, and most importantly, my artistic practice finally, you know, became tangible, like suddenly it came out. So my work comes from different places, and so is my inspiration, but it constantly changes. And there is mythology and literature and obviously painting because of my background, and also the way I approach the language of photography. It's a very simple, basic way of working. You know, it's one light. I love daylight. My work is entirely analog. I work on film with the old Hasselblad that my father gave me, so it's medium format. And my studio is like very simple. It's more, again, it's a space for thought where everything is low, and it's a very intimate experience to engage with the subject and all that stuff. So it comes from different places, and again, inspiration is everywhere, but no matter how far I go and how much I think I'm learning, and how wider my knowledge becomes, somehow all these things that inspire my work, they all come back somehow to the same few places, which are actually the things that shaped me as a child, which is, in my case, you know, the animal world, the natural world, the body, its vulnerability, the flesh, a certain kind of humanity, and a square, basically, which I've been pretty obsessed with for a few years, until very recently, finally, I'm moving on from this. And blackness, which is, you know, not the absence of life, actually, it's all the possibility together. And in this darkness, you know, the figures appear almost like a revelation. And there is, you know, it's interesting because it's really through photography that I did shape my world, my imagery. And since the very beginning, this universe appeared to be already so clear with a specific kind of, you know, humanity. And they all somehow reveal themselves with this, they all appear in my head, you know, covered in dust with some sort of feral look. And I don't have an answer for that. Also about the characters I work with, because I got asked many times, you know, where did you find these people? Who are they? Who are these characters? It's about, you know, nothing is by chance, and you're privileged enough sometimes that you meet some people on your path, and somehow, you know, they trigger something inside you that is already there. So they already belong to my universe, so I must work with them. And then you're so lucky to share that experience and share this journey. My process is very simple. I sketch a lot, I draw a lot, and of course, in order to do all this, again, it's very necessary for me to step out of this past confusing times and just take, you know, a slower way of working. And when you see any work of art, and it could be a photograph or a painting or a sculpture, you see obviously the final result. You see the end of a journey. But this journey, at least according to my experience, is a journey that starts from far away. It's a journey that is mostly made of darkness, of doubt, of fear, of constantly questioning yourself and, you know, getting lost. So it's a place of darkness and total uncertainty, really. But within that apparent confusion and, you know, darkness, there are what I would call sudden sparkles of beauty, of grace, almost really wonder, enlightenment. And because as an artist, you know, you really live, the condition you live, it's the dichotomy, you know, proper dichotomy of being an artist. So on one side, you have this certainty of the vision, the idea, when it possesses you, is like, it's like having an epiphany, you know, you get possessed completely by this force, and then it just, everything makes sense in that moment, and you close your eyes, and for example, the way I work, my process, I can close my eyes, and when that happens, and it's so rare and beautiful and strong, everything seems so tangible and doable. It's almost there, and you can feel, you know, you can see the colors, you can feel the texture. And then when you wake up from this trance, it almost feels that, you know, the work has been done, but it hasn't, you know, it doesn't, it's not there, but it's almost, it's been there because it exists within you. So that's on one side. And on the other side, so on one side you have this certainty of the vision, and so there, it's tangible, it's sharp, and it's existing. And on the other side you have the reality. And reality is brutal, it's violent, it's distracting, it's loud, and it's a compromise, it's frustrating. And it comes with its Jurassic times, at least according to my experience, perhaps more people are faster in their practice, between, you know, the idea and its actual realization. So, yeah, as an artist, basically, you stand between these two conditions. And it's a terrible place to be, technically, because it's absolute uncertainty and darkness. But for 1 second of that thing that you feel, for 1 second of that grace, all the struggle is worth it. So it doesn't matter what happens next and how long it takes, but as long as you can feel that, as long as you can feel that drive, that need, then you're safe. Then you can believe in your work. Or at least that's what happened to me. So I'm really sharing, you know, the way I feel when I get invested by ideas. It's the only thing that you can really hold on to. You hold on to that, and then you can go wherever. It doesn't matter. So I'd like to show you some of this work, because I started saying that it's very important, I think it's relevant these days, and especially in my practice, to go back to a more simply a slower way of working, like a more basic, intimate way of perceiving life, experiencing and making art. This photographic work is, you know, this technique, it's called wet plate collodion. It's an old technique, 1851, and it's very, very challenging, quite difficult. And it requires, you know, a very specific understanding of space, of light, and a very specific engagement with the subject as well, because they need to be extremely still for a very long time. And so far, I think that the wet plate collodion technique, it's the closest thing to the notion of slowness when it comes to photography, or image making, perhaps. I don't know. And I happened to experiment with this technique. I started like 2 years ago in a very interesting time of my life when I was really doubting the medium of photography, and I was like, I don't want to do this anymore. It's not enough. I want to see my characters moving, and also how many more images do we have to deal with? I mean, it's so much, you know, this overload of information these days. So a friend of mine suggested I would experiment with this, because it really brings you back to, you know, the core of image making. Like, you really go back to an awareness that we lost these days of fast consuming, you know, consumable images, like fast producing and fast consuming images. And it's true, and it was true. It's an extremely slow process, and you shoot on this metal, which are called tintype, and you have to develop it straight away, and between the actual emotion with silver and salt, so it's pure photography, the roots of photography, and then you shoot, and then you have to develop it straight away, so you see it happening, the miracle of photography. So it was really a way of going back to craft, like really taking the time and the responsibility as an image maker, because you do have a responsibility when you make work of art. And it was beautiful, you know, like super, you know, intimate with this. So that was very important for me, because it renewed my love for photography. So I kind of, okay, I can still do this, you know, because I came back to a very intimate way of image making. And also the result. Now, what you see here, these are some stills from my film. Because 1.5 years ago, I had the opportunity to to shoot the film. It was a commission by the London Contemporary Orchestra, and I'm grateful for the trust, because, you know, before then I never shot any film. It was like photography and painting, but again I was feeling like, you know, what it's not enough. And they arrived and were like, okay, so why don't we do something together? And so we did this film, and I had no idea what I was doing, and I was terrified. Again, super uncertain territory. You're like, what am I gonna do? But then it worked, and it was a great experience. You know, we shot in Iceland, and it became a big installation last year in London at the Roundhouse, and it was quite intimidating. It was a massive scale, full immersive, and it was beautiful. And doing this, you know, experimenting with moving images opened up so many opportunities for me from my practice that really I felt, okay, this is great. I can do whatever you want, whatever I want. It makes sense, because even if it's a different language, it's a new language, it's a new tool in my toolkit, but I can still recognize myself. And that's for me the most important thing, because all I've been trying to do in those past 10 years through photography is really trying to achieve what I think is the most difficult and also most important thing to achieve, which is your style, your signature. And once you have that, you know, there's nothing else. And these are more stills. And yeah, so basically, currently, I'm feeling exactly as I was feeling 10 years ago, as I told you, in this total uncertain time. I don't know what's gonna happen. I don't know which form my work is gonna take. But the difference between me now and 10 years ago is that at the time, I was paralyzed. I was absolutely scared. But I worked so much with one language, in my case, you know, photography, just that thing, that the difference is now I'm just very excited. So whatever will happen next, I'm not scared. I mean, of course I'm scared because uncertainty, you know, but still, whatever happens is great. And the point is that what's most relevant for me in my practice right now, and it's really the slowness, like going back to a more basic and, you know, slower pace of making work. And because our time is really lacking of silence, which is the silence of thought, the silence for contemplation, and the responsibility of the artist is really to protect and defend ourselves and men from all this confusing stuff that is happening around us. And art must really urge viewers, spectators, listeners to really stop, to hesitate, and perhaps really, you know, dealing with what I think is the fear of contingency, and, you know, create a place where a different practice is possible and a different way of living is possible that is more slow. And slowness not as a trick to, you know, decelerate or twist, you know, the our fast modern time, but perhaps as a mode of movement and perception. So uncertainty as well as slowness is, I think, it's a very powerful resource, and, you know, we must embrace it. Thank you.